Dana, thank you very much for this kind introduction. Hello to everybody, and also good morning, good afternoon, and good evening for me. I'm happy to tell you now some things about new developments in automated winning systems. First of all, I would like to give you an overview, the agenda from this webinar. The first topic will be that I will show you just some big things about modern winning strategy. And the second item will be automated winning systems, and thereby I will give you an overview of the actually available systems and the basic technologies used in these systems. And afterwards, I will give you a quick overview about over the clinical studies that investigated these systems. So let's start. I think every time when you stand at the bedside of your patient and this patient is on the ventilator, you must recognize that mechanical ventilation is harmful. And the last 20 to 30 years of research gave us some ideas about factors that may contribute to the potential harmful effects of mechanical ventilation. And here I listed you some and the most important factors. The first factor is called barotrauma. So we know now that ventilating a patient with high inspiratory pressures, so inspiratory pressures more than 30 or 35 centimeters of water, we know that this is harmful to our patients. And also ventilating your patients with high tidal volumes, especially in patients with acute respiratory distress syndrome, is also known to be harmful for the patients. The next thing is that a phenomenon is now visible in CTs, for example. So there is a phenomenon called atelectasis trauma. So this is cyclic closing and reopening of alveoli, and this induces an inflammatory response of the lung and perhaps of the whole patient. So this is a very injurious factor for the patient. The last and I think also very important thing is that every time when suppression of spontaneous breathing activity happens, this is also harmful for your patient. So in consequence and keeping these factors in mind, when you want to give an a modern winning strategy must have, I think, one main target. And the main target is that you reduce ventilation time and thereby you eliminate these possible harmful factors on your patient. When you have a look into the literature and when you want to try to reduce the total ventilation time, you probably recognize that you have to use one tool, and these are weaning protocols. In this slide, I summarized five of very big weaning studies, more than 300 patients included nearly in all of these studies. And the blue scale is the group that was ventilated without a protocol, and the red scales are the study groups where ventilation protocols or weaning protocols were used. And you see in four of these five studies, we have a significant reduction of total ventilation time when the patients were weaned with a weaning protocol. Only one study published by Krishnan and co-workers in 2004 showed no significant difference between the two studied groups. And when you look into the publication and look into the environment where this study was performed, to get an idea, this was a 40-bed ICU, and there were six residents, two postdocs, and two attending physicians, and there was a routine use of structured standard checklist. And therefore, I think in such a well-equipped environment, you do not have to use weaning protocols. But for example, in a European context, we are not so well-equipped with such many stuff in our ICUs. These some of these studies were summarized from two task forces, and these two task forces gave recommendations for the use of weaning protocols. The first task force was an American task force, and this task force recommended that weaning protocols that are designed for non-physician healthcare professionals should be developed and implemented in the ICU. And the second task force also recommended that weaning protocols are most valuable in hospitals in which physicians otherwise do not adhere to standardized weaning guidelines. But you do not solve your problem just by hanging a weaning protocol at the bedside of the patient. So we know that it is very hard to implement such weaning protocols into the daily clinical routine. For example, in the context of sepsis, we also know that it is very hard to implement new findings in sepsis therapy into the daily clinical practice, and thereby people created things called sepsis bundles, where they just picked up one easy to transfer thing into one bundle, and this bundle was implemented into an ICU, and then the outcome was measured from this bundle. So we know that it is hard to put protocols into practice, and I think one good idea would be to automatize such a protocol. And this is the rationale of my webinar today. So a protocol for weaning patients from mechanical ventilation can be implemented into an automated ventilation system. So when we have this idea, we have to look a little bit into the details of automated weaning systems. And surprisingly, the first automated ventilation system was already published in 1953, so more than 50 years ago now. And here, this is a short overview of the systems that were published, and also also the basic technologies that were used. So surprisingly, 49 automated weaning systems were already published. In my opinion, a very high number. And there are many different basic technologies used. For example, we have a very high number of so-called feedback controllers, 27 feedback controllers. We have also many knowledge-based systems, or knowledge-based systems combined with the physiological models of the lung. We have two fuzzy controllers, three model-based systems, two electronic protocol systems, and also one belief network system. But we know that only four of these systems are commercially available to the customers. The first system, and the oldest system, is the mandatory minute ventilation. This mode just controls the mechanical breathing frequency according to a user given minute ventilation. Auto mode is also an automatical switch between assisted spontaneous breathing and pressure controlled ventilation. Adaptive support ventilation is a semi-automatic system, and I will show you some details later on. Smart care pressure support is a system that controls the pressure support in patients who are already breathing in assisted spontaneous breathing mode. But actually, no system is able to control all of the ventilatory settings, and I will focus my speech now on the two highlighted systems here. I will start with adaptive support ventilation. This is a mode based on pressure-controlled synchronized intermittent mandatory ventilation plus pressure support, and the system chooses an optimal mechanical breathing frequency and an optimal tidal volume according to the pulmonary mechanics, and the thing behind is the measurement of the respiratory time constant. It is a semi-automatic mode, so the user has to set up the inspired fraction of oxygen, the positive end expiratory pressure, and the minute ventilation by hand. But the system is a very, very nice tool for an automatic transfer from controlled to assisted ventilation, for example, for patients suffering from general anesthesia. This is an overview of the clinical studies that investigated adaptive support ventilation. I selected only the randomized control trials of these systems, and we have four studies, and we have a relatively low number of included and completed patients in the first two studies. And also in the control group, the authors used SIMV pressure support, and I think it is really well known that this mode is the absolute slowest mode for weaning patients. And we have in two studies a significant reduction of the ventilation time when ASV was compared with the control group. But when you look at the numbers, these are very, very short weaning times. So I think these patients will not seriously profit from an automated weaning system, because these are just patients that were only extubated. And I think you do not really need an automated systems in these short-term ventilated patients. So let's come to SmartCare pressure support. When you want to use SmartCare on your patient, you have a precondition. So the patient has to be already in assisted spontaneous breathing. And the system just makes an automatic change of the pressure support level according to some measurements that I will show you later on. In this figure, you see the automatic control of the pressure support level. In this example, it starts with a pressure support level of 20. And for example, if the patient is stable, there will be a decrease of the pressure support level. And depending on some preconditions, also depending whether you use automatic tube compensation or not, the pressure support level will be decreased, for example, by automatically. And Dojard and Brochard, who developed the systems, defined just empirically a so-called comfort zone for the patient. And these are the main targets that the system tries to reach on your patient. So, and this comfort zone is defined by three parameters. First of all, the system tries to keep the spontaneous breathing frequency between 15 and 30 breaths per minute. Second, the tidal volume should be greater than 300 mL, and the end tidal CO2 concentration should be lower than 55 millimeters of mercury. And when you start SmartCare, the system first tries to transfer your patient into the comfort zone, then stabilizes the patient into the comfort zone. And afterwards, there is an automatic decrease of the pressure support. And when the pressure support is at a relatively low level, and that depends on some preconditions, also when the PEEP is set to lower or equal than 5 centimeters of water, an automatic spontaneous breathing trial is performed by the system. And when a patient passes this trial successfully, the ventilator displays the message "consider separation." So this is a real recommendation for extubation of the patient. I will show you two patient examples, and these are online. These are real patient data. You see here the timeline, the time curves of the patient, and here you see the inspiratory pressure and the PEEP. So PEEP is the blue line here in this. So we start with a PEEP of 8, and we start with a relatively high pressure support level with 27. And when you start SmartCare, the system automatically starts with the first phase. It's called adaptation. In this phase, the system tries to transfer the patient into the comfort zone. And when all preconditions are fulfilled for the spontaneous breathing trial, the observation phase is automatically initiated. And then when this trial is passed successfully, the weaning success is maintained in the so-called maintain phase. And you can easily see that in this patient, the pressure support level could be decreased. It starts a little bit slower, and then the system determines that the patient does not need such a high pressure support level. And then the PEEP is decreased from 8 to 5. Then this spontaneous breathing trial is initiated and passed successfully by the patient. And afterwards, the system remains in the maintain phase. And at the end, this patient could be extubated successfully. Second patient example, so the same layout of the figure. This patient started with a PEEP already of 5 centimeters of water, and the system was started and started in the adaptation phase. First of all, the pressure support level was kept constant in the start. Then the pressure support was reduced stepwise. Here in this peak, the patient showed a tachypnea, and the pressure support level was shortened, raised up, and was then decreased immediately. Then a spontaneous breathing trial was initiated, but the patient did not successfully pass this spontaneous breathing trial, and the system changed in the adaptation phase. There were another 2 phases of tachypnea, but then the patient passed another spontaneous breathing trial successfully, showed short phases of tachypnea that were compensated with a short increase of the pressure support level, and afterwards we could also successfully extubate the patient. Now let's come to the clinical trials that investigated smart care. I will show you now 3 studies. The first study is published by Lelouch and co-workers in 2006 in the Blue Journal. They included 145 patients, and they had an inclusion rate of 14%. And this was a multi-center trials in 5 university teaching hospitals. And patients that were long-term ventilated, so longer than 24 hours, were randomly weaned with a protocol or with the smart care system. And this study has some methodological limitations, and I displayed here 2 things. The first thing is that the weaning was conducted according to usual local practice in the control groups, and only in 4 of the 5 units written guidelines were available. So the topic of this study was to compare smart care with the local daily clinical practice. But we have a relatively low number of patients in the control group, and thereby the control group may be a little bit confounded. However, this is the Kaplan-Meier curve of the total ventilation time. So you see on the x-axis the days of mechanical ventilation, and here you see the probability of remaining on mechanical ventilation. And the dotted line is the control group, so the usual weaning group called in this publication. And the solid line is the curve of the smart care patients. And in this study, the authors found a significant reduction of total ventilation time in the patients that were weaned with the smart care systems. And giving you some numbers. Here's the protocol group, here's the smart care group, and for example, the time until the first successful extubation was reduced by the smart care systems from 5 to 3 days. The total duration of mechanical ventilation was nearly halved by smart care, coming from 12 to 7.5, and this had also an effect on the length of stay on the ICU, so also the ICU length of stay was shortened by the smart care system. And comparable to the studies investigating adaptive support ventilation, you see that this study, for example, was a real weaning study, because we have a long, so these are days and not hours, so we have a much more longer ventilation time. Next study that I will show you is a study of our research group in Kiel. So the study of Lelouch and co-workers stimulated us to design this study. But we had a different focus. We wanted to investigate smart care in our daily clinical routine. And I will show you in the study design that we had that our study was focused on another patient population. And we included in our study 300 patients. We had an inclusion rate of 60%. and also as comparable to Lelouch and co-workers, we compared randomly a local strict weaning protocol with the automatic weaning system SmartCare, and the study lasted for 2 years. So here's the design that we choose. So the only inclusion criteria that we used was that every patient requiring mechanical ventilation at 9 a.m. in the morning for longer than 9 hours may be possibly included into the study. And this is the map of our practice, because normally all our patients, so these are only post-surgical patients, and normally these patients were extubated during the evening or during the night. And when a patient does not have a real serious problem, the patient will normally be transferred to the normal ward, and every patient who is on the ventilator at this point of time may have any problem, and we were interested whether the system may be quicker in weaning the patients when we started the system at a very early time point. We had to use some exclusion criteria. For example, patients following cerebral surgery or patients that had a cerebral trauma. In these patients, we expected that they might confound our study, because such patients often need a long period of time in deep sedation, and these patients may be a confounder in our study. In Germany, it's a problem to include patients that are younger than 18 years. And also in patients with do not resuscitate order, we did not want to include these patients. And also patients that were ventilated for longer than 24 hours were excluded, because we wanted to see the effect of SmartCare in the very early weaning phase. So all the patients that fulfilled inclusion criteria and did not fulfill exclusion criteria were included and randomized either to be weaned SmartCare or to be weaned according to our weaning protocol. Baseline characteristics of the two studied groups. We did not have any significant differences regarding the age, gender, or the Apache 2 score, and a priori we defined three different subgroups. One subgroup was patients following cardiac surgery, one subgroup was patients with known COPD, and another subgroup were patients with sepsis. And we had an even distribution of these three subgroups in our patient population. So here's the main result. This is the total ventilation time, so another Kaplan-Meier curve. The red dotted line is the total ventilation time of our SmartCare group, and the blue solid line is the protocol group. And one might expect a trend to a shorter ventilation time in the SmartCare group, but the p-value is 0.18, so there is no significant differences between the two studied groups. But in the subgroup cardiac surgery, for example, this we had a significant shorter total ventilation time in the SmartCare group. So this specific subgroup may profit from an automatic weaning system. Some other figures of our study: we had no differences of alarms per hour, but we had a lower number of manipulations per hour in the SmartCare groups. And this was also statistically significant. And we had a higher number of manipulations of the ventilatory settings. And this was the automatic manipulations of the pressure support level by the SmartCare system. Outcome parameters like 28-day mortality, 90-day mortality, length of stay in ICU, or length of stay in hospital, we had no significant differences between the two groups. Now let's come to the last study. This is a study from Australia, published by Rose and co-workers in 2008. Another study that investigated or that compared a local weaning protocol with SmartCare. 102 patients were included, also a difficult study design and a relatively low number, low inclusion rate, only 10%. 51 patients were weaned with a protocol, 51 were weaned with the smart care system. This is also the Kaplan-Meier curve of this study, and we see absolutely no significant differences between the two studied groups. But when you look into the publication and you look into the environment that was used in this Australia setting, we had a one-to-one nurse-to-patient ratio, for example, a team of 9 intensivists directed overall patient care, and twice daily structured ICU ward rounds were performed. So this was also a highly staffed ICU, and therefore I think that was also a successful result for smart care. Some tips for the practice if you want to use smart care on your patients. The first thing is that smart care is not a really fully closed loop controller. So you have to care about all the other ventilatory settings. You have to care about FiO2, about PEEP, about the pressure slope, for example. And I think when you perform a clinical round and your patient is on smart care, you have also to look into the system. There is a special smart care view defined on the ventilators where you can look into the system, where you can follow up the pressure support levels, for example, and also the diagnosis and the therapies that are evaluated by the systems. And I think this must be a part of the clinical round to understand the system and also to get a clinical view of the patients by the system. The next thing is when the patient is stable in the comfort zone and the PEEP is set higher than 5 centimeters of water, the system displays a message that is called PEEP 5 centimeters of water. Or in the newer software version, there comes a question, PEEP reducible. So when you see this message, that means that smart care wants to start the spontaneous breathing trial, but in the older software version, this is only available when the PEEP is set to 5 centimeters of water. Then in newer systems, you can adapt the target PEEP. So if you have a patient that who is ventilated with a PEEP of 12 or 40 centimeters of water, for example, be aware of this message, because sometimes it may happen that people just set the PEEP to 5 because the ventilator displayed this message, and then you have normally serious oxygenation problems. The third thing is that you have considered dead space. The system tries to control the alveolar ventilation, and thereby it interprets the data coming from the expired CO2 concentration. So every time before you start the smart care system, you have to attach the CO2 measurement at your patient, and please confirm with an arterial blood gas analysis that the arterial CO2 concentration and the expired CO2 concentration are nearly equal, or that your dead space is not too high, because otherwise I recommend not to use smart care system. The last thing is, do not interrupt a patient session whenever possible. The system gets a feeling about your patient, and some of the diagnoses and also some of the time rules that are implemented in the systems are depending on the time the patient is weaned with the smart care system. So thereby, it might be of benefit for your patients when you try to do not interrupt patient session. So I will summarize now this webinar. I think that a lot of work was done to develop automatic weaning systems. And unfortunately, today only a small number of systems are commercially available. Adaptive support is a promising mode, and the idea is a very good. We have a very good idea, but it Unfortunately, it was only evaluated in post-surgical patients and in only short-term ventilated patients. I think some patient populations, like long-term ventilated patients showed by Lelouch, or, for example, showed by our group's patients following cardiac surgery, may profit from an automatic weaning with SmartCare pressure support. But we need further multicenter trials to determine the effects of SmartCare in these different patient populations. And it is important to use specific protocols in the control group. And further on, we need development, and I think it may be possible to control more or nearly all of the ventilatory settings. So with a view to the Baltic Sea of Kiel, I thank you very much for your attendance, and I will hand over now to Berner.